have one announcement to make before we go on. I know that we have people moving out. We have, at NYU, we actually have Friday classes, so we have students moving in and out. And some of you may not realize that the papers are all actually posted. They're posted on the NYU webpage about this conference. And if you would like the address for that post, if you ask Jason outside, he'll be glad to hand you the web address where you can reach all the papers. Our second panel is on inequality, and the moderator of this panel is Jason Oh, who is a relatively new faculty member at UCLA. Before he went to UCLA, he was, the reason for my Freudian slip here, is he was an acting assistant professor here at NYU, and it gives me a great deal of pleasure to welcome Jason back to our midst. Jason.
Thanks so much, Deborah. The second panel focuses on inequality and taxes. This topic is particularly relevant if you've watched the presidential debates. So today we're joined by David Kamin, assistant professor of law at NYU Law School, Eric Zolt, Michael H. Schill, distinguished professor of law at UCLA Law School, and Len Burman, Daniel Patrick Moynihan, professor of public affairs at the Maxwell School of Syracuse University. So I'll let David take it away. His topic is poverty, not inequality. Oh, and just one quick programming note. We're going to allow each of the speakers to take their 20 minutes. There's enough overlap and friction between the papers that I think it makes sense to hold questions till the end. So David, take us away.
So it's great to be here to talk about inequality, the effect of the tax code on inequality. I think, as we've seen, it's been a topic of vast public debate in the last few years, and really it goes back quite some time. And so, as you can tell from the title of my piece, I actually think to an important extent we have the wrong topic. And there has been a considerable debate, and we keep talking about inequality in the tax code and how much the tax code can affect inequality. And the argument I make is that in practical terms, its effect is actually limited, is likely to continue to be limited, but that doesn't mean we shouldn't care about the distribution of the tax burden. So to start us off, I'm going to first note the fact that for a long time, people have been talking about the tax burden and inequality. So first quote here, of course, is Thomas Jefferson. As we probably know, Jefferson was certainly concerned about the rise of a potential aristocracy. And so in this particular quote, you see him suggesting the fact that a progressive tax on property could be one way to address inequality. The second quote goes back to just about the 100 years ago, and as was referenced, there was a considerable debate about how we were going to raise the revenue to fund the federal government. And at the time, tariffs were in the lead. And you see the Democratic Party platform, where it describes how tariffs are a principal cause of inequality, making the rich richer and the poor poorer. And this is in the same Democratic Party platform that they applaud the soon-to-be income tax. And finally, I give you a quote from Barack Obama from just last year in his speech in Kansas, where you see again, and this was in a portion of his speech where he referenced the Buffett rule, which was the rule that no person making over $1 million should pay less than 30% in taxes. And you can see it's perhaps not quite as direct a reference to inequality, but it certainly gets to the fact that he talks about a few doing fantastically well in the middle class fighting, and this was in the context of talking about taxes. So in all of these places, we see there's been a long time link drawn between our tax code and overall inequality. So as I suggested, while that is true that we talk about it frequently in those terms, in fact, the very title of this panel is inequality, I think that the effect of the system in practical terms is actually very limited on overall inequality. So to be clear, I'm not making a theoretical argument. There are those who might say, just based on first principles, based on your own theory of tax fairness, inequality should not be what we focus on. That's not what I'm saying. There are also those who might say, you know, there's, for instance, a classic sort of intellectual principle or academic principle called Maximin, which is when you build your social welfare function, what should you focus on? And there are those who say that based on that, we should focus on the welfare of those at the very bottom. That is what matters. Overall inequality shouldn't matter. Again, that's not the claim of my paper. The claim of my paper is instead that there are many people, myself included, who may think that overall economic inequality, you know, all else being equal, is not something that is attractive, that is something that has negative aspects, and there, I know a few people on this panel will talk more about those, but there are people out there who have been talked about the effect on democracy, the effect on economic growth, and so we may want to try to fight overall economic inequality. At the same time, I think many people would probably agree that poverty and, you know, the welfare of those towards the bottom of the income spectrum is something that we should be concerned about. And that, you know, and certainly going back over time, you remember there's a classic speech by President Roosevelt calling from freedom from want. And so again, these two principles, the principle that we may not desire economic inequality and we also don't desire poverty, are two things that I sort of say is sort of the base principles that underlie my paper. But I go from there and say, in terms of the actual practical effect of the tax system, it can only really have a large effect on one of these things. It will not probably have a large effect on inequality. It can have a very large effect on poverty. So now, before I dive into that, we sort of first have to ask, what do I mean by poverty and inequality? Because it's actually not self-evident. So I start off with sort of the classic drawing when it comes to inequality. And this is the Lorentz curve, named after the economist who first drew such a curve, I believe. And also, you can see written onto this slide is what's known as the Gini coefficient, which is probably going to get referenced a number of times by the other speakers. So for those of you out there who have not necessarily previously seen such a graph or seen the Gini coefficient defined, this is a way of measuring overall economic inequality. The idea is you on the bottom, you see on the x-axis, you see percent of the population. And so it goes from 0 to 100%. On the y-axis, you see percent of income earned by a given portion of the population. So if my line, the blue line, went along with my black line, that would indicate that we have a society with perfect income equality. The idea being that at the 10% mark, 10% of the population would have earned 10% of income, 20% mark, and so on. Now, that line gets further and further bowed out as the society becomes more and more unequal. So this is a way of summarizing the overall equality in the country. And the Gini coefficient, which you see there is written, is a way to further summarize this picture. It is essentially, and I'm quickly going to dive just into a little bit just so you understand what we're talking about, it is area A, so the area between my black line and my blue line, divided by area A plus area B. And so perfect inequality, Gini coefficient is 1. Perfect equality, Gini coefficient is 0. In the United States right now, we have a Gini coefficient of about 0.43 after taxes and after transfers. And this is in 2009. So, you know, the Gini coefficient is much debated. It's not like there's a whole literature out there saying whether it's the right way or wrong way to measure overall inequality. And it, you know, depends on how you define what you care about, but it's certainly not a bad way, and from purposes of my paper, it's what I'm going to use to try to measure effects on overall inequality. Now, what has happened to the Gini coefficient? There's a number of the other papers will describe this in greater detail, but as you can see, over the last 30 years, and this is based on data from the Congressional Budget Office, we've seen a significant increase in the Gini coefficient after taxes and transfers. Now, to put this in other terms, whereas in 1979, the top quintile earned about 42% of income, in 2009, they earned 47% of income. For the top 1%, it went from 7% to 11%. And importantly, 2009, as you can see, may actually be a good year. That is because we had entered the Great Recession, and there was a massive drop-off in capital gains for people at the very top. So going back to 2007, a more hopefully normal year, you can see, in fact, inequality in that year was even higher, where the top quintile earned 51%, the top 1%, 17%. So this is all compared to 1979, which was actually a relatively low point for income inequality in this country. So basically, over the last 30 years, we have seen growing income inequality in the country, what Paul Krugman, for instance, has termed the great divergence. So this gives you a context of what we're talking about. When we're talking about the tax system and income inequality, this sort of provides the background that part of the reason people are so concerned about it is that there has been a vast increase over the last 30 years. Now, what do I mean by poverty? Perhaps even more so than inequality, the very concept of poverty elicits considerable debate about what that means. So for purposes of my presentation, I'm going to actually use the official poverty rate. And the official poverty rate is it's well known within the literature within the economic literature was sort of famously developed by Molly Orshansky of the Social Security Administration. It is an old concept. She did it based on food. There are many others who say that we should be using different numbers, alternative metrics. One of the key weaknesses of the official poverty numbers is it doesn't take into account a number of things. For purposes of our discussion, one of the most important things it does not take into account is taxes. Actually, so when you see the official poverty numbers, it does include cash income, but it is on a before tax basis. So people have developed a number of alternative poverty metrics, which are better, have greater coverage. The main change I make as we go through is I add in taxes, just so you can see the change in trend in poverty once you take into account the tax system. And I think basically, irrespective of which exact poverty metric you use, you will find the same thing. The tax system, the change in the tax system and their treatment of those in poverty over time will be the same irrespective of exactly how you define it. But in terms of poverty, I think what we're fundamentally concerned about is economic deprivation, as the National Academy of Sciences termed it, or a minimally adequate standard of living. And so you can see in terms of trend, according to the official poverty measures, we're at a relative high point in terms of the last 30 years. While in the 1960s we saw poverty in around the 20s, it's been bouncing around, but right now is around 15% according to the official poverty metrics, which is not great. And of course, it is sensitive to economic trends, and the Great Recession drove it higher. Now, why do I say inequality versus poverty? And why do I say that I think the effect of one effect on poverty can be much greater than the effect on inequality? It comes down to a pretty simple intuition, where a lot of it does. Put simply, if you take a family, let's say you have a two-person society, one making $10,000, another making $1 million, and this is on an after-tax basis, and I shift the tax burden so that I decrease the taxes of those making $10,000 by $1,000, and I increase the tax on those making $1 million by $1,000, we will find that the overall income distribution has barely budged. So if what I cared about was the effect of this system on democracy, the effect on economic growth, my guess is I've not improved things very much at all. However, $1,000 to the person making $10,000 is not insignificant. It's a 10% increase in their income. And you can see pretty simply, Gini coefficient in this case barely changes. Income shares barely change. But the welfare of the person at the bottom has increased significantly. So this is a simple intuition. When you have a system of a given size, it can have a much larger effect on welfare in terms of people at the bottom than it can necessarily on overall income. Now, to sort of put a fine point on it, I run through a few different hypotheticals to sort of indicate exactly how this works. And so I have a system which is raising about 20% of GDP. The federal tax system raises, hopefully, about 20% of GDP. It's right now around 15%, but hopefully is trending up. And if you have a system and you keep it fixed and you say we're going to raise 20% of GDP, you can imagine some extreme systems. You can do a poll tax, the most regressive system probably people would ever think of, simply because it's the same amount per person. Also, people tend to think it's very efficient, even if very inequitable. You can imagine putting the burden entirely on the top 20%, or you can imagine a proportional tax. Now, what happens? Well, in terms of inequality, not surprisingly, when I go to a very unequal system, inequality increases. Poll tax increases the Gini coefficient to 0.58 from 0.46. The most progressive system takes it down to 0.35. Now, This looks like, I mean, there's no doubt, like in terms of these like really extreme systems, I'm seeing some significant moves in inequality. However, I think we should put these in context. For instance, the most progressive possible system we could have for federal taxes would simply return us to the same Gini coefficient that we had in 1979. So if you are trying to actually offset the increase in inequality that we've seen since 1979, it requires having the top 20% pay all federal taxes. It sort of puts in context, you know, when it comes to a system that raises only 20% of GDP, the choices of how that's distributed is not going to necessarily have as big an effect as you might think on overall inequality. Now, how about poverty? The effect, it looks much larger. And admittedly, it's a bit apples and oranges. I'm talking Gini coefficients versus poverty statistics. However, with a poll tax, we see the official poverty rate move up from 15% to well over 30%, more than doubling. A proportional tax increases it from 15% to 21%. And not surprisingly, if you concentrate it all at the top, it will have no effect on people in poverty. And this is not to say this is necessarily the full range of possible effects of the system, because of course the system can actually deliver dollars back to people at the bottom, but it is indicative in just comparison to the effect on inequality that you see a much larger effect in terms of one than in terms of the other. And if we think both of these are concerns, I perhaps will be much more concerned about this when it comes to the tax system than when it comes to overall inequality. So now getting out of hypotheticals, what has the effect been over the last 30 years of the federal tax system? And as you can see, over a time it actually has seen some considerable changes in rates, fundamental tax reform, different treatment of capital gains, sometimes taxed at ordinary income, sometimes taxed at preferential rates. The effect of the tax system on the Gini coefficient has gone in a relatively narrow band. So, you know, we see it ranges from negative 0.04 to around negative 0.025. In the last 10 years, has actually been relatively stable. Compared to overall inequality and even the change in overall inequality, these are relatively small effects. Now, considering actually real proposals, so that's looking back, looking forward, what are the possible effects of different plans? Now, this isn't nothing, but you can sort of see that if we continued current policy, not surprisingly, we continue in effect that's around negative 0.04. President Obama's budget, which is probably the most progressive proposal that we could imagine enacted under the current political constraints, increases it a bit. Republican-led tax reform, and here I was making it up, 20% cut in rates with an across-the-board cut in tax expenditures. It's a little unclear what that is, but I sort of made it up based on the details we have. Also has an effect on inequality, but again, relative to the overall economic trends, I think you'll see these aren't massive, and if you expect a compromise, it doesn't necessarily look like a huge effect. Now, what about poverty? So I'm going to quickly flip through two charts, and one shows the official poverty rate adjusted for the effect of the tax system, and the next shows the actual effect of the tax system. So I'm going to keep it here, and I'll reference the other one. The effect of the tax system on poverty over the last 30 years has been it's completely transformed. It's gone from adding to poverty by about 2 percentage points to significantly subtracting from poverty. And so if you look at where poverty is right now, you'll actually see that despite the fact that we're recovering from the Great Recession, poverty right now is actually below the average of the last 30 years. And this is because of the development and expansions of the EITC, it's about 60% of the change, child tax credit, about 30% of the change, and another 10% of the change are temporary measures that were in place in 2009 and 2010, like making work pay. So even as the system has not changed very much in how it treats overall economic inequality, even while that's the case, it has transformed in its effect on those at the very bottom of the income spectrum. And I just went through that. And so finally we get to proposals. So what will this look like? And again, I think you can see, and if you compare this to an overall poverty rate of about 15%, the effect of 2010 policy, President Obama's policy, which reduces poverty just somewhat less than that, current law, which would actually have a tax system that increases poverty, And then finally, the stand-in for Republican-led tax reform. The effects relative to overall poverty are significantly larger than in terms of the effect on overall economic inequality. And it further puts a point on that when we're focused on distributional effects, the actual effect on welfare may be much larger than the effect on sort of overall income, the overall income distribution. So I've quickly run through a lot of numbers. And so, you know, what do I take away from this? So let me first look glass half full. I think there are a number of books out there that have also noted the fact that the tax system has a relatively small effect on overall economic inequality, has had a small effect over the last 30 years, and isn't contributing much to the increase in economic inequality, and isn't doing the opposite. From that, you might say, I shouldn't care that much about the distributional tables. Tax reform will happen, it may happen, it may not, but you know, guess what? They're not going to affect economic inequality, so I shouldn't care much about distributional analysis. I think this would say that's not true. It's true that it probably won't have an effect on overall economic inequality. You should find other tools for affecting overall economic inequality, but that doesn't mean it won't affect welfare. It can have a very large effect on the welfare of people towards the bottom of the income spectrum. And so that's the glass half full in terms of why we should care about distribution. On the other side of the coin, it means that when it comes to talking about inequality, you shouldn't spend too much time thinking about the tax system. You should think about the other tools at your disposal.
Next, we'll have Eric Zolt presenting on Inequality in America, Challenges for Taxing and Spending Policy.
Thank you, Jason, and thank Deborah for her efforts and Jason in putting this all together. We live in difficult times. We have a stagnant economy, unsustainable tax and spending policies, growing inequality and wealth inequality. And we're also stuck in a political rut. Democrats claim the rich are not paying their fair share and seek to increase taxes on the rich to pay for social policy. And the Republicans seek to reduce taxes and to make the government smaller. I'd like to pick up on two themes from David's presentation. First, what's the villain? Who's the villain? And if you're focusing on high levels of inequality, you may have less efficient and productive economy, reduction in social capital, undermining democratic process. Or it could be increasing poverty, and I'll add to David's discussion, reduction in economic mobility. And how you weigh these two different views will have different effects on the fiscal policy. Second, I'd like to emphasize David's point that we have a bigger toolkit than just focusing on the federal income tax, that spending programs are more effective in addressing poverty and economic mobility concerns, okay? And that my major takeaway here is that we may need less progressive taxes to support more progressive spending programs. So what I'd like to do is focus on four different groups of misconceptions that may influence our tax and spending policies in a time of rising inequality. First, misconceptions about equality. Second, about the level of economic mobility. Third, about government expenditures. And fourth, about the role of taxes in reducing inequality. So let's start with the three misconceptions about inequality. First, the different views. Second, that we may give different weight to outcomes other than, insufficient weight to outcomes other than income and wealth inequality. And finally, we may focus too much on the aggregate income statistics without understanding other aspects of inequality. So again, one view of inequality is to focus on calls for redistribution, that the solution is take from the rich, give to the poor. But in contrast, we could also focus on poverty reduction or economic mobility. Second, it's important to focus on measures of inequality other than income inequality or wealth inequality. So this could be inequality of consumption, as Kevin Hassett has recently done, inequality of different outcomes like life expectancy, education, housing, better medical care, as Klain Pope has done, or perhaps most important for my discussion, inequality of opportunity. And here the World Bank has done some interesting stuff in Latin America. And then finally, the aggregate statistics may hide important trends among different groups in society. So several factors influence inequality, as David said, changes in real earning growth, changing demographics, and geographical dispersion. And the point is that if we look at the aggregate stories, we're missing the difference between men and women's earnings over this period. We're missing a lot of demographic changes, as Ann Allstott will talk about later, the rise of the new individualism or the decoupling of America. And what's interesting to me is you can explain a lot of inequality just by looking at five counties in the United States. And if you add it to 15, a lot of it goes away. And that tells you that the inequality phenomena is not so much an American phenomena, but one that may be more limited to the coasts. So if I step back, and this is again a similar chart that David used, the only thing I add to this is separating it out by a population group. And the line at the very top is the retirement age inequality, and you can see that's dramatically higher than the rest of the group. And this is from the largely attributable to wealth inequality among retired people. The most common statistic reported in academic circles and in the popular press has been the relative income growth of the different groups. And here we have average growing by 62%, but where the top 1% has seen their income grow by 275%, the bottom has seen it grow by only 18%. And the result of this is we have increasing dispersion between the median and the mean income. The IRS also examines tax returns of the top 400 taxpayers. And it's interesting, in 1962, you needed $24 million to qualify for this elite group. By 2007, the number is $138 million. And inflation adjusted, that's about $87 million. The numbers peaked at $34 million in 2000, and now in 2000, the last year, 2008, is at $21 million. But this is a remarkable increase over a relatively short period of time. And it's hard to say that these outsized returns are really justified. Do these people really deserve it? So to think about that, I'm borrowing something from my colleague Bill Klein, is to look at the salaries of Kobe Bryant, Magic Johnson, and Kareem Abdul-Jabbar. Now, I'm a Bears fan, I'm a Chicago Bulls fan, but I appreciate how great these players were. And their salaries in their MVP years differed greatly. So Kobe in 2008 earned $21.3 million and paid tax at a 35% rate. Magic Johnson in 1990 earned $5 million or $7.8 million inflation adjusted and paid taxes at 31%, but early in his career paid at 50%. And Kareem Abdul-Jabbar in 1981 earned $1.1 million and paid taxes at 70%. So again, Magic Johnson earned about 37% of Kobe's salary, and Kareem earned about 11%. Now, is Kobe Bryant worth $20 million a year? And certainly he deserves it if I compare it to other people being paid $20 million. But it's not clear to me, but it's not clear to me that the relative progression makes sense. And you can have similar results here, whether you look at corporate executives, investment bankers, lawyers, and much less dramatically, law professors. So as striking as these numbers are, the capital gains numbers are even more striking. So the average capital gains for the top 400 peaked at $228 million in 2007 and have dropped to a paltry $92 million in 2009. So if you wanted to increase the tax burden on the rich, this seems like an excellent place to start. So like David, what are the results of tax and spending policies in reducing inequality? Well, here's a table, and again, what I've added is the reduction in the Gini coefficient, and the green line is those over age 65. So this dramatic reduction is really due to two things. One, high initial levels of inequality among this group, but also government programs targeting the elderly. But for a variety of reasons, taxing and spending policies are less effective in reducing inequality today than they were 30 years ago. The spending is less directed at poor people, and on the tax side, we collect more of our revenue from payroll taxes, which are not progressive relative to the progressive income tax. And compared to other countries, we have relatively high levels of before-tax inequality and among the highest levels of after-tax inequality, once considering the tax and transfer programs. Now, moving on to economic mobility, I'd like to put forth two possible misconceptions. First, I think there's a real gap between perceived and actual economic mobility in the United States. And second, although we pride ourselves as the land of opportunity, economic mobility in the U.S. is likely lower than other developed countries. And I think part of the misconception is attributable to this man, Horatio Alger. Horatio Alger was a 19th century author who wrote the same story over and over again. It was work hard, thrift, self-improvement, and even the poor can earn a respectable middle-class living. And I think this opportunity and optimism is good both for the economy and for political stability, but it also fosters this notion the poor can get rich if they just worked hard enough. As an aside, Horatio Alger's interest in young boys was more than literary. He was removed from his position as a Unitarian minister, and he also was not allowed to coach football. So why are the rich rich? So one answer, they're rich because they have greater ability, education, work harder, more innovative, they're taller, and they deserve what they can earn in a market economy. Or it could be inheritance of human and financial capital, social and government connection, or just luck. And then why are the poor poor? They could be poor because they made bad choices, they're lazy, or it could be because they have less opportunity or bad luck. So perhaps, there you go, so perhaps not equal opportunity, not an even playing field. Now, some work by the Pew Charitable Trust looks at mobility across generations. And from there, we see that it really is sticky at both the top and the bottom. That 43% of people who start off in the bottom end up at their end of their life, and 40% who start off at the top are fortunate to stay there. And here's a Brookings studies that looks at mobility among different countries. This looks at how much of the son's earnings can be explained by the earnings of the father, and again, with the exception of the UK, the US is much more, has less mobility than other countries. Despite that, if you ask questions about mobility, what role the government should play, should we be concerned about inequality, the US is clearly an outlier with respect to other countries. So next I'd like to move to misconceptions about spending programs, and here I have three. First, we may underestimate the size of social spending programs. Second, misidentify the beneficiaries. And third, we may fail to appreciate how much indirect social spending we do through tax expenditures. On the first one, the US always prided itself as having a small welfare state compared to Western Europe. But when you do some adjustments, particularly looking at adding in our indirect spending, the gap is a lot smaller than we have. We have changing beneficiaries. In 1979, the bottom quintile received more than 50% of the transfers, but in 2007, that's down to 35%. We have increased spending on the elderly. They received 62% of the transfers in 1979. And it's up to 68%. And what concerns me is households with children received 19% of the transfers in 1979, but only 12% in 2007. So it sort of makes one want to transfer several hundred billion dollars from Medicare to spending on the population at large. As to social spending through the tax system, we lead the world in using tax subsidies to encourage private social spending. And a recent article by Eric Toder and his co-authors shows how skewed the benefits are, with the top two quintiles receiving about 90% of tax subsidies for retirement savings and ownership, and the top two quintiles receiving about two-thirds. And again, when we look at how we use the tax system, much more for subsidies targeted at economic mobility and a lot less at income maintenance. I'd like to conclude by talking about the final set of misconceptions relating to the role of taxes in reducing inequality. And here David has already talked about taxes play a relatively small role in both causing and correcting inequality. But the other three that we may lack a good understanding of the distribution, that we may underestimate progressivity in the US system compared to other countries, and we also may have too narrow a view of taxes and reducing inequality. So here's an important point. The rich have gotten so wealthy, so rich, it is now possible to reduce tax rates for everyone and still keep the federal tax to GDP rate at its rough historical average of 18%. This chart is from Larry Bartell's Homer Gets a Tax Cut, and it really has been the strategy as tax cuts for everyone as a way of packaging tax reform. And so you have winner, winner, chicken dinner in looking at how we structure our federal taxes. Now, during the National Convention and the Republican and Democratic National Convention and the presidential debates, I heard a lot about Democrats feeling that the rich do not pay their fair share, and from the Republicans that the poor pay no taxes. So I will focus on the middle class. And here's my minor insight. From a federal income tax perspective, the middle class, particularly the second lowest and the middle quintile, has never had it so good, at least since 1942. It's just that everything else is so challenging. So this view would change if you added in payroll taxes and state and local taxes. But what we have is a new type of bracket creep. In our efforts to reduce the tax burden on the poor, we have carved out the tax base in the middle. And in some ways, we have the worst of all worlds. We have low average rates, but high marginal tax rates for this group. So we get low revenues, but high distortions. So if you look at the numbers, this is the share of federal tax liability, the second column, individual taxes. It's just 2.7% in 2009. So the middle quintile is responsible for 2.7% of the federal income tax. If you look at their average tax rates, it's now down to 1.3% in 2009. That's down from 3% earlier in the decade and 8% in 1981. Now the tables are hard to read, so this shows it in tabular form. And the olive green in the middle shows the tax contribution of the middle quintile. This came from, prompted by Greg Menkew's blog, looking at CBO data. And it's sort of fascinating. This looks at all federal taxes and all government transfers. And if you look at 2009, the green part is market income, the red part is direct transfers, the blue part is federal taxes. So the middle quintile paid $7,700 in federal taxes and received $10,400 in transfers. So when you look at the middle class tax burden, it's low historically, but it's also low in comparison to other countries. This is some OECD data that looks at federal income, payroll taxes, and state income taxes. And if you see, particularly for families with two children, the rate in the United States is much less than it is in other countries. So it's only 8.2% compared to other developed countries. And this is even more striking when you consider that our consumption taxes are much less than the consumption taxes in other countries. So in conclusion, where does this take us? Well, at one level, we have three alternatives. We can just maintain our current tax revenue base with increasing social and other government spending. That's clearly not sustainable. We can still pretend to be a low-tax country, in which case we'd have to make dramatic changes in our spending policy and in our taxing policy, particularly if we wanted to follow David's recommendation to reduce poverty and my recommendation to try and increase economic mobility. Or third, we can adopt an explicitly medium-sized government model. And here's the takeaway. This may call for less progressive or even regressive taxes to fund more progressive spending programs. So since just about everybody has their own tax proposal, I'd like to put mine forward. First, adopt a value-added tax to raise revenue and to reduce revenue requirements from the individual and corporate tax. Second, adopt what is called the dual income tax, where you delink the taxation of labor and capital income and rationalize the taxation of capital income with a single rate. Third, reform individual corporate tax regimes by expanding the tax base and reducing tax rates. Stop spending, doing indirect social spending through the tax system. And finally, look at larger social programs that will equalize opportunities and address the basic needs of those at the economic bottom. Thank you.
And now we'll have Len Burman presenting on taxes and inequality.
I feel this real obligation to prove that I'm not just here because I'm tall. I want to thank Eric and Deborah for organizing this, Eric for organizing this session and for inviting me. I guess I'm a little bit embarrassed because I'm the economist on the panel and I never mentioned Gini coefficients in my talk, in my paper, although I just did in my presentation. That's the last time I'm going to talk about them. The problem is I spend a lot of time talking to real people. You start talking about Gini coefficients and they leave. So I'm also following Eric's model. I stole a bunch of cartoons last night, so I'd have some funny images on my slides. My talk, I'm going to talk about some background data, some of which I'll go through very quickly because it actually is similar to what some of the other speakers have talked about. I'm going to talk about the role of the income tax. I want to talk about the existential threat created by the lucky duckies. And I want to talk about what the role of the income tax should be in the second century of its existence. So these are some data from the Census Bureau. It was actually put together by Alan Krueger. And it's a way of looking at this great divergence. The left-hand panel shows income growth by quintile from 1947 to 1979. You can see it was very, 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 very similar across income groups. And then in the second period, from 1979 to 2010, the people at the top got enormous income gains. People at the bottom actually fell behind when adjusted for inflation. This is just a chart showing how the middle class has done over the last 30 years. And basically, they've gone nowhere. They've been in a recession for 30 years. Their incomes haven't changed. Now, some people would look at this and say, well, we're just looking at their marketing, their cash incomes. And a lot of their compensation now goes to pay for health insurance. So if you added that in, then you'd actually be a lot better off. So you tell real people that the reason that your paycheck hasn't changed in 30 years is that you're spending all of your raises for the last 30 years on increasingly expensive health care. That doesn't make them happy either. When we talk about, I think Eric made a really important point saying we shouldn't just look at taxes, we should also look at spending. One of the differences between us and these other countries that actually have relatively more regressive tax systems is that they pay for that health insurance is provided by the government. And in that case, if we had that kind of a system, assuming that everything else was the same, middle class people would have significantly faster growing incomes. So one question is, why has this divergence occurred? And one possibility, and if you watch the Republican convention, you probably would have inferred that this was the case, is that middle class people are really lazy. And I don't think that's true. Here's some data on civilian labor force participation over from 1979 to 2009. And these are for people working full-time, 25 to 54 years of age. And you can see, well, maybe men are slacking off a little bit. There's been a slight decline. But in terms of overall, there's been a big increase in labor force participation. 30 years ago, a lot of married women in particular weren't in the workforce. Now, almost all of them are. And overall, the middle class is working harder than ever. We compare the United States to the rest of the world, and we work harder than anybody. So it's certainly not the case that income distribution is just widening, because they're really, really hardworking people are getting huge returns at the top, and then everybody else is slacking off. So I thought probably I'd refer to the poem by Yeats, the center did not hold. This is showing the dwindling middle class. It's another slide I stole from Kruger, showing that the percentage of the population that's within 50% of median income. Median income for a household now is $40,000 or something like that. So people are between $20,000 and $60,000 at current levels. And you can see that in 1979, half the population was within that band. By the year 2010, it was only 42% within that range. So what are the causes of economic inequality? Basically ruled out laziness. So this is a slide just showing, when you ask economists what do they think is driving higher economic inequality, these are the most common answers. One is technological change. It's produced a huge return to education and ability to use complicated equipment, things like that. More than 40% of the respondents said they thought that was the most important thing. Second is other and unknown. International trade is a significant factor. A lot of workers, particularly unskilled workers in the United States, are competing with workers all around the world. That's actually technology and trade. The fact is that you can produce things in Bangalore, you can produce them in Illinois. And that means that for a whole lot of kinds of activities, workers have a lot more competition than they used to. Decline in the minimum wage, decline in the role of institutions and labor unions have been identified as important factors. Notice that immigration is a pretty small part of the overall story, at least as economists assess it. The other thing is, and I think David was alluding to this, is just this, actually I guess Eric did in his slide with the basketball players, there's been this evolution of rising share of overall economic profits, of returns going to people at the very, very top of their professions. So right now we're in the death throes of the divisional the National League Championship Series. The American League is already over. Sorry. And you look at A-Rod, who gets, I listened on ESPN this morning, and he makes like $164 billion a year, something like that. And there's I live in Syracuse now. I don't get to see Major League Baseball, but I see the minor league players in Syracuse. Those are really, really good baseball players. They're better than A-Rod, but they're almost as good as the average Major League Baseball player, and they earn a tiny, tiny fraction of what the Major League Baseball players earn. And say, well, that's maybe just unique to baseball, but in all different kinds of fields, the people at the very, very top, the CEO makes 100 times as much money as the guy down the hall, who's almost as good, might have been a competitor for the job. So there's been this change in just the evolution of compensation. This chart, it's not actually where I thought it would be. This chart is another way of just looking at rising inequality over time. It's basically telling the same story as some of the other presentations. It did remind me when David was talking about how, well, inequality was greater before the Great Recession, and then it declined. I got a phone call from a reporter saying, okay, we've had this major financial meltdown. That means that income inequality is going to get better, right? That's kind of a silver lining. I said, well, actually, when people are thinking of reducing economic inequality, they're generally thinking of bringing people in the middle up rather than bringing people at the top down and people at the middle down just by less. This chart just shows, actually, it's similar to one that Eric just showed, just shows income shares in selected countries over time. The blue line, basically the countries are arrayed from the most unequal to the least unequal around 1949. And you can see the United States is right in the middle of the pack. In 2005, the United States, by this measure, at any rate, the share of income going to the top 1%, had the most unequal income distribution among any of these rich countries. So it's actually true that other countries are becoming more unequal, but inequality is growing faster in the US than it is in the rest of the world. Now, you might say, well, you know, you don't care about it if people have an equal chance. You might say you don't care about it generally because you don't care. But the fact is that, and I think actually Kim alluded to this earlier, that there's some evidence, at least, that economic inequality has negative consequences for the economy overall, that more unequal economies grow slower than economies where distribution is less skewed. The other thing is that if income inequality gets very, very extreme and you have a democracy, you have a country where people get to vote, assuming middle-class people start voting, or middle-class people actually do vote, and they vote their own class interests, which in the United States they have tended not to do, but if they did, if things got bad enough, they might vote and support things that really would be inimical to economic growth, like trade restrictions, lots of regulations on businesses, very, very high minimum wages. I think actually some increase in the minimum wage after the economy recovered probably would not have a great economic cost, but if the minimum wage was increased to $15 or $20 an hour, that could be very costly. So it's very possible that the income tax is a much less costly way of reducing economic inequality than some other measures we may think of. So, the role of the tax system. Another cartoon. there's an economics professor at Princeton emailed that to me. So this chart shows just pre and after tax shares of household income for the bottom 20 and the bottom 80% and the top 20%. And the left-hand panel is pre-tax. And you can see that the shares, that they've been diverging, but roughly there's a split between bottom 20 and the top 80%. When you include the role of the income taxes, payroll taxes, estate taxes, and corporate taxes, it doesn't include excise taxes, basically the top 20%, their share is brought down, the bottom 80%, their share is increased. Well, so obviously the income tax can reduce economic inequality. It's not the perfect, certainly the current income tax is not the ideal instrument for lowering economic inequality because we don't measure income very well for tax purposes. I did a paper some years ago with Bob Schiller who had this great idea that we should just have the income tax automatically adjust to reduce economic inequality. And we ran that through the big computer and what we found was that first of all, it's hard because a lot of income just isn't even subject to tax. But also, there was wide divergence. When you start raising tax rates on the top and lowering tax rates at the bottom, you reduce average inequality between the top and the bottom, but you also increase the variance of after-tax returns. There's a lot of income that isn't included in taxable income, as everybody in this room knows. I mean, there are exclusions from income, like health insurance provided by employers. You've got people living on tax-exempt bonds who don't have any taxable income. Something else here. People's homes people's homes actually generate income. People who own their own homes and paid for it are obviously better off than people who are renting or have substantial debt. Those things aren't reflected in the income tax. So I'm going to get back to that later. But basically, just this idea that when you just look at these aggregates, you see that you're reducing average inequality, but there's also an issue in terms of just the variance of the after-tax returns. Higher tax rates actually magnify the mistakes in the income tax. This chart just shows, one very crude measure of what the income tax is doing to reduce inequality. You can see at the same time that, in the 19... 50s, 60s, and 70s, the share of income going to the middle class was actually quite high by historical levels. It had fallen from depression levels. And then in the 1980s, 1990s, last decade, the share of income going to the top was increasing pretty dramatically at the same time that marginal tax rates are declining. And right now, the top marginal income tax rate is a little bit higher than it was after the Tax Reform Act of 1986, but it's very low by historical standards. So there are a couple of ways of looking at this. One is obviously that the income tax is going the wrong direction. Another one, if you talk to conservatives, what they would say is, look, it just shows, you know, what happens. You lower marginal income, you lower marginal tax rates, and the people at the top become more and more productive. And that's why they're getting rich. So there's a question about causality. Conservatives are wrong, but never mind. I did want to just give the opposing point of view. If you look at the data over time, another issue is about the composition of taxes. We tend to focus on the income tax, maybe the income tax and payroll taxes. There are two very progressive taxes in the federal arsenal. There's income taxes, I guess, including corporate and individual income taxes, and estate taxes, which only apply to the estates of very, very wealthy people. And then there are these regressive taxes, the social insurance taxes, the payroll tax, the Social Security payroll tax caps out at about $110,000 of earnings, and excise taxes, which are on things like tobacco and alcohol and tires, which are also extremely regressive. That what this chart shows is that the share of overall federal receipts raised by those regressive taxes has increased at the same time that the share raised by income and estate taxes has fallen. So there's been a compositional shift. Now this is important because we talk about income taxes, we're missing the main part of the story for most Americans. That the chart shows the taxes as a share of income for individual income and payroll taxes. The income taxes are net subsidies for lower income people. They get the earned income tax credit, the child tax credit. Payroll taxes are actually significant positive taxes. If you look at both the employer's and the employee's share of the payroll taxes, it comes 15.3%. Virtually all economists think that employees end up paying the employer's share of payroll taxes, that basically employers pay them less than they would if they didn't have to pay that tax bill. So 15% is a lot. If you're earning $20,000, which for a family of four gets you just to the poverty level, that's $3,000 a year in taxes. Looking at just the employee share of taxes, the employee share of payroll taxes is more than income taxes for half of Americans. Basically, the bottom two quintiles and a significant fraction of people in the middle pay more in Social Security taxes than they pay in income taxes. So it's wrong to just look at the income tax. Skip that. The other thing is we tend to ignore state and local taxes, and one reason is that states are hard. There are 50 of them, and you've got to collect a whole bunch of data to figure it out. But Citizens for Tax Justice actually does have a state tax model, and state taxes are much more aggressive than federal taxes. First of all, their income taxes tend to be very flat. Some states don't even have income taxes. They rely much more on sales taxes than the federal government does, and sales taxes are very regressive, and they rely more on excise taxes and fees. So taken overall, while the federal tax overall is pretty progressive, when you include the effect of state and local taxes, it's pretty flat from the fourth quintile on, and it's much less progressive than it appears to be. So the existential threat to our democracy created by the lucky duckies. The public's attitude towards progressivity, towards redistribution, still favors a fair amount of progressivity in the tax system. We generally favor a more progressive tax. Overall, when you survey Americans, they want to help people who suffer bad luck, who can't take care of themselves, although there's a growing party divide on that. I just saw a recent survey where a majority of Republicans said that they didn't think that the federal tax should help take care of people who couldn't take care of, their federal government should help take care of people who couldn't take care of themselves, and Democrats overwhelmingly supported that. The other thing is we don't want to help the shiftless. And this has sort of played into a whole debate about what the federal government should be doing. As David pointed out, we do a lot to help low-income people through the tax system. This chart shows major cash, major spending programs and two big refundable tax credits. The child tax credit applies to people with incomes up into the low six figures, but it's actually partially refundable. So lower income families with children can get a significant benefit. The earned income tax credit, $49 billion in 2009, is actually the biggest cash assistance program for working age people by the federal government. It's much bigger than TANF, sort of traditional welfare. It's about as big as food stamps. So it's very important. A large part of the social safety net is moved into the income tax. And this is just another way of looking at it over time. What you can see is that child tax credit, the earned income tax credit, have increased over time, the EITC pretty dramatically, whereas traditional cash welfare has gone away. And say, well, this is a good thing. We're helping people get out of poverty. Maybe not. Have we become a nation of takers? This is something I got by email from the American Enterprise Institute. And Mitt Romney put it somewhat different way. I think you've all heard the quote, 47% of people think they can actually count on, they think they're victims, they think the government has a responsibility to care for them, they believe they're entitled to health care, to food, to housing, to you name it, and they won't vote for him either. The Wall Street Journal actually started this line a long time ago. This is from a 2002 editorial about the lucky duckies. And the lucky duckies were the people who were lucky enough to be really poor, so they didn't have to pay income taxes. I sort of drafted a response I didn't send to the Wall Street Journal. I said, you know, everyone who reads this newspaper can become a lucky ducky if they want to. Say, you know, the CEO can trade jobs with the person who cleans the executive washroom. I'm sure they would go along with this. But the concern is that there's a threat to democracy, that workers who pay little or no taxes can hardly be expected to care about tax relief for everybody else, but they're also that much more detached from recognizing the costs of government. And I'm running out of time, aren't I?
1 minute.
1 minute. So the lucky duckies actually do pay other taxes. Most of them actually work. So they pay payroll taxes, in some cases a significant amount. Significant fraction of them, 10% of the people, 10% of households, the one and including a third of the lucky duckies, are elderly people, and we just decided that old people who live on Social Security and not much else don't pay income tax. My guess is that Mitt Romney doesn't want to change that, at least not before the election. And there are a bunch of non-elderly people who are just really poor. Their incomes are below $20,000. And then the 1%, those are the ones who have really good tax layers. Only kidding. Now the thing is that these programs, and David mentioned this too, it's just no way of looking at it. The biggest anti-poverty programs we have are these tax credits, the earned income tax credit in particular, reduces the number of people in poverty by 4 percentage points out of that 15. The Census Bureau has come up with a new alternative measure of poverty that actually accounts for any poverty programs, good idea. And the EITC is the most significant factor. So what do we do about that? Or, you know, there's the worry that, you know, as part of, you know, many, many decades of compromise between conservatives and liberals, we said, well, we're going to get rid of these big government programs, and so we're going to move the whole safety net into the income tax. And now we find out that, that wasn't maybe so bright, because now we have tax reform, and the tax reform basically eviscerates the safety net. Here's my bottom line. One is that the income tax is a useful instrument to address economic inequality, that there's a significant amount of redistribution now, and there's an argument for more given what's happened in terms of rising economic inequality over time. You'd like to deal with the fundamental, you know, the underlying causes of inequality. You'd like to create more educational opportunities and training and all of that. But in the interim, the income tax is a useful instrument. It's very, very imperfect. And it would make a lot of sense to convert to, as part of income tax reform, to do something like what Lily Batchelder, Fred Goldberg, and Peter Orszag suggested, which is to tax a very broad measure of income and then convert the income tax subsidies into tax credits. And the idea is that then everybody, you know, basically, the big problem is that the IRS has two jobs. One is they collect taxes to finance the government. The other thing is they run 200 programs through various tax expenditures. It would be nice to actually make it clear that, you know, that the tax part of that, that individuals are paying a significant amount of tax, and people at all income levels are getting significant subsidies through the tax system. The ideal thing would be to turn the subsidies into credits. Alternatively, just as a stopgap, what I would like the IRS to do would be to send everybody a note basically saying, congratulations, you're a lucky ducky, even though you didn't know it, that here's what you paid in tax, here's what you got in subsidies. Subsidies including the mortgage interest deduction, the exclusion of health insurance, and all those other things, and you earn income tax credit and the child tax credit. And then when we talk about what the government should be doing and how the tax system should work, we could talk about all of those things together. Thanks.
So far this has been a love fest. But I think listening to these three great presentations, there are actually some areas of friction between them. And before we open it up to questions, I wanted to ask the panelists to comment on a few different points. The first is every panelist mentioned the Gini coefficient at some point. And it ranged from David's point, which is if we look at the effect of the income tax system on the Gini coefficient, it doesn't seem to be doing that much. So let's look at poverty. And then it ranged to Len, who said, I feel contractually obliged to mention the Gini coefficient before moving on to other measures of inequality. So the first question is, well, what role should the Gini coefficient play in this debate over inequality and taxes?
Well, I guess the first answer would be, as probably as Len said, and I broke the cardinal rule, so in terms of the public debate, probably very little. Otherwise, no one's going to understand what you're saying. Maybe what you're getting at is like, what role should the overall income distribution play? I mean, like, and there are various ways of summarizing it. One way is the Gini coefficient. People could come up with others. My bottom line answer was sort of the thesis of my paper. It's possible the tax system could end up having a significant effect on overall economic inequality. I'm just doubtful that in practical effect it's going to be that large. So in terms of like the effect of tax reform, I wouldn't be so much focused on what, you know, its change in the Gini coefficient or Lorentz curve, because I think that that will in fact understate some of the negative effects you might see. And I think we should be more focused on the actual welfare of middle class or people at the bottom, especially, because I think that's where actually like the significant effects could be seen from changes in the tax system that we might actually contemplate.
I'd just like to add a couple of things to David. First, I think it plays a useful role in that we have a measure that people can agree on. They can agree on both the strengths and the weaknesses of the measure, but they can use it to compare the U.S. over time. They can use it to look at different groups. And I think there are other ratios, Jason, whether it's the ratio of the 90th percentile to the 10th percentile, ratio of the 50th percentile to 10th percentile, which would make the discussion richer. But I think having a summary statistic is a lot helpful, more helpful, and is very helpful in framing the debate.
There is a really... The problem with the Gini coefficient, the problem with the charts that I showed, is that there's kind of a fundamental question about what the tax system should be doing. Do we just care about how the pie is? The criticism is that, well, you could make the pie 80% smaller and you have it really, really equal. And that clearly wouldn't make us better off. There is a question about whether, you know, a lot of the political debate has been about how you treat people with incomes between $100,000 and $200,000 and $200,000 and $300,000. I joked at one conference where Bill Gale and I were speaking that really I didn't care about Bill Gale's income or Bill Gates's income, but that the concern is about the subset of people who are really kind of struggling, the bottom 60% or maybe the bottom 80%. The Gini coefficient is useful as a summary statistic, but it's only a little part of the story. The real question is, if our resources are really limited, or we believe the costs of reducing inequality are very, very great. You know, do we just want to focus on people in poverty? There certainly are things we could do to help people in the middle, even if they don't show up as a big statistical change. And in fact, as Eric pointed out, middle-income people are paying little or no income taxes, and that's a big change from 20 or 30 years ago. Perhaps more should be done. Whether it should be done on the tax side or on the spending side is, and also the spending programs don't show up in the Gini coefficient either, and those are important. So we also need better measures of what people's economic status is, and the reason we don't have them is because it's really, really hard.
All right, thanks. So the second question, and I guess I'll let Len and Eric comment on this first and then David rebut. Len and Eric, what, if anything, do you think is lost if we reframe the debate solely in terms of poverty rather than more broadly about inequality?
I think there's a political problem in reframing the debate just in terms of poverty. I really do care. Mitt Romney said at one point, I don't care about the very poor. And then he said, no, actually, I do. I just was misspoke. There are lots of reasons to care about people in poverty. Poverty has all sorts of bad economic effects. And the worst thing, even if you think that people make bad choices and that's why they end up being poor, is it doesn't just hurt them, it hurts their children. And poverty is perpetuating from generation to generation. But the problem is when you focus programs just on the poor, people think it doesn't apply to them. And particularly in the United States, there's a racial component. People think of poverty programs as affecting people who are different from them, or they might especially not want to help. So I think there actually is an advantage to thinking of programs that would be more, say, if you think the problem is that that low-wage workers don't get compensated very well, maybe we should be rethinking the earned income tax credit and think of it in terms of, say, a wage subsidy that would apply on the first $10,000 or $15,000 of earnings and be available to everyone with earnings, you know, whatever level. Basically phase it out through income taxes generally rather than through a phase up of the ITC and then a phase down. That it would also make it a lot simpler for the IRS to enforce. When you look at programs, Social Security is a fabulous anti-poverty program, but the reason it's so popular is that everybody thinks they benefit from it.
So I think a lot would be lost if we just focused solely on poverty reduction, didn't focus on levels of inequality. I'm afraid we're becoming two countries, and for a while I was worrying that U.S. was becoming more like Latin America. But as Latin America has become more equal, I think that may be a good thing. But in a world of limited resources, you know, I share David's concern that what you should be focusing on is the people on the bottom, and also the economic mobility. I think I'd be much more willing to tolerate higher levels of inequality if I thought the economic opportunities were more equal. And I think there are real economic and political costs to the levels of inequality that we've reached in the last 10 or 20 years.
So first, to agree, I actually think that something considerable would be lost if all we talked about was poverty and not inequality. However, and then to sort of go a step beyond that, what I'm arguing is not actually in terms of the, you know, theory of it. Do we care about inequality? I think you're exactly right. There are like serious concerns about inequality and reasons why you think inequality in itself may produce negative effects for society. The point is that if you're that person who is concerned about inequality, there's a question of how much time should you be sitting there coming up with different types of tax reform. And I think the answer is you should be spending a lot of your time trying to think about things beyond the tax system. Because what I was trying to present was the fact that the tax system actually is, in terms of its distributional effect, pretty good at some things. We've seen over the last 30 years a transformation of the way it treats people at the bottom and significant effects in terms of like increasing their welfare relative to where they otherwise would be. But in terms of where like the practical constraints on our tax system and the practical constraints on tax reform, I see it as very unlikely that it is going to have a significant effect on overall income inequality relative to broader economic trends. And so we better be exploring other tools, and whether it's, you know, financial regulation, education policy, or something else, people should be spending much more of their time thinking about that when it comes to overall economic inequality.
All right. So I guess one last question for our panelists to respond to. We've mostly been focusing on inequality of outcomes, right? So poverty, income, and the role taxes can or cannot play in reducing that inequality of outcomes. I wondered, what role do you see for the tax system play in reducing inequality of opportunity, if any?
I think we actually try to do too much of that through the tax system already. There are tax credits for education, there are tax credits to encourage employers to hire particular kinds of workers, and I think the evidence is that those things don't work particularly well. I think it would be much better to actually focus attention on, say, improving K-12 education, improving access to higher education through things like Pell Grants and subsidized student loans, doing more for young children in poor households who, when they enter school, they're at a huge disadvantage already because, you know, we've had this push to get parents on welfare to go to work, and they have, and their children have gotten either terrible child care or none at all, just sitting in front of the television, and they've also been under enormous stress, and there's a lot of evidence that that puts them way behind before they even enter kindergarten. So doing more there, I think, would be a much more productive use of resources.
Yeah, I agree. I think the tax system is not going to be very effective unless we move to a completely refundable credit system for many different types of credits besides the earned income tax credit and child tax credit. And again, I agree with Len that the answer's got to be on the spending side, and that's why I think I'm willing to tolerate more regressive taxes to raise the funds for K through 12 education, for Head Start programs, for job retraining programs, for extending the school year for school age, and extending the school year to help those who don't have the same educational resources at home. So Alan Kruger has a really wonderful article where he looks at different types of programs that can improve economic mobility. And again, it's a bigger toolkit than just relying on the tax system to do that.
And so I broadly agree with the points that were just made. I think the caveat I would add is that we shouldn't disconnect the idea of equality of opportunity from also the idea of poverty, and especially for people who are very young. And our tax code, and as people have said, especially because we've expanded is the earned income tax credit, which gives the largest benefit to families with children, and the child tax credit, which is now partially refundable. Its effect on child poverty is actually considerably outsized, even as compared to its effect on overall poverty. And I think there's actually been some studies looking at, you know, effects of expansions of tax credits, of such tax credits across the states on health outcomes for young children. And so being able to lift children out of poverty, I think probably will have some relationship to their future mobility. And so I think, I agree that some other programs are probably best considered on the spending side of the equation, whether it's like trying to figure out how to provide educational opportunities, but we shouldn't necessarily overlook the fact that, especially when it comes to lifting kids out of poverty, the tax code has become one of the most effective tools.
All right, so are there any questions? George, you want to take us away?
Yes, thanks. I'm George Yan from the University of Virginia. I had a question for Len. Len, I thought you did a nice job in explaining the winner-take-all model, the notion that the major league player is unlikely to change much in terms of effort and so forth by merely because of higher tax rates, because of the tremendous gap between the pre-tax compensation of the player and somebody who's just slightly not as good in the minor leagues. It's interesting to note, though, if you think back, that that two people on opposite ends of the spectrum, and I'm thinking of Ronald Reagan and Bill Bradley, presumably didn't, or at least seemed to not agree with that perception, although maybe you have a different idea about that. But I wanted to ask you about people who at least initially don't seem to fit in that winner-take-all model. And so let's just take an example, the kind of example that's bandied about in the political debate today. So you have an owner of a small unincorporated firm with five employees thinking about bidding on a new project. The project would require hiring two new people. The owner would have to incur some additional effort and time, certainly more responsibility, certain some degree of risk, but obviously some possibility of significant increasing in profits. And so now, and let's assume the person is subject to the top rate or almost the top rate. What does the literature say about that person and the effect of the changing rates on that person as opposed to the, you know, the Ronald Reagan, the actor, and the ball player, and so forth. I don't want to get into the macro issue, which is where the political debate tends to be, which is, you know, how many firms really are there like that, and how important they are to economic growth. You know, let's abstract that away, and I'm just thinking really of the micro issue, which is we do know that there are some firms like that, and we also know that there are ball players, and, you know, what is the relative responsiveness of them to a change in rates? And if there is a difference, is there any way that we can differentiate them so that we can say to the ball players, we're going to jack up your rates, but we're not going to do it if in fact we feel that jacking up the rates is actually going to affect the behavior in real ways of people in this other category?
Thanks, George. There are, I guess, a couple of points. One is that I actually went to Washington to work on the Tax Reform Act of 86, and I thought that the idea of lowering marginal tax rates by broadening the base was a good idea. So when you think about getting more progressivity, there are two ways you could do it. One is by raising rates, and the other is by broadening the base in ways that are progressive. And obviously, the broadening the base is far preferable on efficiency grounds. And whatever mistakes there are in the income tax, whatever incentive effects are created by the income tax are magnified when rates go up. The effect of taxes on small business are an enormously contentious issue. The fact is that the income tax is pretty advantageous to entrepreneurs now, particularly the ones who filed individual income tax returns. There's a nice paper by Roger Gordon and a co-author which listed half a dozen different reasons why entrepreneurs were really actually favored in the income tax over, say, wage earners. And one is that they can deduct all sorts of expenses that they couldn't deduct if they were filing an ordinary income tax return. The second one is that they deduct even more expenses than that. I mean, the rate of noncompliance for small businesses is pretty low. It's like 50%. Third is they basically get to expense the contributions of labor by the entrepreneur, that to the extent you work for a company and you take a very low salary for a long time, it's like you're making a contribution of capital. It's your human capital, and it's not included in your income. So basically, you're taxed on a consumption tax basis to begin with. So the question is, these advantages are all magnified at a higher tax rate than at a lower one. So it might well be the case that if top tax rates went up, you'd see more people going into small business. And as for your question about how it affects the decision to hire, and certainly if all you're looking at is, you know, hiring an additional worker and abstracting from the employer's contribution of effort to managing them, that taxes wouldn't affect this trade-off really at all, because you hire somebody if you think they're going to produce enough to make you a profit over time, and the profit is smaller at a higher tax rate, but it's still positive. To the extent that there's, I hadn't really thought about the issue of the employer himself actually contributing a lot of his own labor to managing the employee, but that's also, effectively, that's expensed because it would reduce his own compensation. So the other point, of course, is that if we lower tax rates and we do it in a way that raises the deficit, the consequence eventually is going to be higher interest rates, and that would be way worse for small and large businesses than anything we do on the tax side.
Dan, you want to go ahead?
Yeah. David, I had a suggestion of, I would probably, without disagreeing, to reframe or at least think of the point you made differently. But first, I want to illustrate it. In a sense, what you're saying is we have a candidate for president whose plan is to, a part of his plan is to take a bunch of poor people, say to each of them, I'm going to take $1,000 out of your pocket, and I'm going to give it to the very richest people in the country. So you're saying, well, if you kind of look at the effect on inequality, the, of course, this is the correct policy under his Maximax philosophy, but he's, although he also may believe in mini men, but you're saying it really doesn't matter on the high end. You take a rich person, you bundle these poor people's loss, you give the guy a $5 million check, life doesn't really change so much. But the people you took $1,000 away from, their life changes a lot. So in a sense, that's not a critique. That's sort of a way of encapsulating it. But the critique, or rather a framing, is the following. You're, of course, explicitly assuming that the tax level is in effect the same. So then you're saying we're going to have these 1986-style exercises where we kind of, you pay a little more and you pay a little less, and we keep the tax level the same. What I think you're really arguing is not, what, at least the way I, what I take away from it is not that when we talk about tax, we should just think about distribution on the poverty side, but what I really think of it is we need an integrated budget sense of what's going on. Of course, it's also true that poor people could be more affected on the spending side, realistically, than on the tax side, because if we wipe out Medicaid and so forth, the numbers, the real numbers that are at issue are greater, so that kind of matters more on the spending side also. What you're really saying is we need an integrated budgetary analysis in which both taxes and spending are on the table. I mean, just to give an example, I was thinking of a famous result. You have a 100% tax to fund a uniform Demogrant. And so that is the tax doing the work, or is the Demogrant doing the work? And so what I really think, this is consistent with what you're saying, I think is that what you're really saying is that we need an integrated budget sense of it, of things to affect overall inequality in which tax levels are on the table. That's how I mean, that's what I take away from it.
Everyone should be allowed to take away what they want to take away. beyond that statement, I agree with you that it makes sense to look at, you know, the integrated effects of both tax and spending changes. Obviously, you can substitute a spending change for a tax change and vice versa. With that said, I do think that we are going to be making decisions to some degree about tax reform that we really actually right now, maybe it's a mistake, but we tend to look at distributional tables, you know, without sort of, it's a tax distributional table. I'm sure in the midst of tax reform, we're gonna get JCT distributional tables, chances are, after some years of not having them. And people look at the distribution of tax changes, and they will look at the distribution of tax changes within a fixed revenue effect. So they'll say, for instance, they will fix a revenue level as part of tax reform. They'll make an agreement that will hit 19% of GDP or whatever it will be, and then there'll be a discussion about how it should be distributed. And within that, with that discussion, you know, so I was trying to make the point, if you think, and it's not, I'm not sure you do, but if you think that inequality in itself creates certain negative effects for the country, that is beyond just sort of because I obviously, if you're a welfareist, you might not like inequality just because you think it's better to have more money at the bottom. But if you think that inequality in itself creates problems for democracy, or, you know, creates problems for economic growth, the idea is simply that within the bounds of the debate that we're having, the tax system is simply not going to be in all that.
Tax levels have to be on the table.
Well, right, that, but I don't. But look, I mean, you're sure. And if like tax levels were on the table, that we were going to get it up to 30% of GDP, I'd say yeah, that probably we could probably have a large. Then the discussion about how the distribution of that affects overall economic inequality would probably be more interesting than if we're talking about 20% of GDP. But we're not talking about 30% of GDP. We're having a debate about whether it's going to be 18.5% of GDP or 19.5% of GDP. So within that constraint, where we have it, like it seems it's going to be around 20% of GDP, how that gets distributed is simply not going to have that big an effect on overall economic inequality, but that doesn't mean that the distribution doesn't matter.
Hi, my name's Madeline Rumley. I'm here with Cohen Resnick. I'm interning there, and I'm at CUNY getting a master's in accounting. I worked for 3 years at H&R Block in Harlem and in Washington Heights, which are predominantly lower income neighborhoods here in Manhattan. And I mostly did EITC returns, 19 out of 20 probably were EITC returns. And people would get refund anticipation loans and refund anticipation checks, which are now being regulated. And then they'd also usually spend the money pretty fast after they would get it, which bumps up consumer spending in March and April. So my question for you is, how do we structure EITC to not have a lot of that money go to big banks like Chase that underwrite these loans at huge interest rates, and to companies like H&R Block that will take their fees out of people's earned income credit for a very, very large fee? Thanks.
I think probably everybody at this table agrees that refund anticipation loans are a huge problem. It's like an implicit tax, and also the fees charged by H&R Block to calculate EITC returns for low income taxpayers. You know, one of the advantages of the reform I mentioned, which is to turn the EITC into just a wage subsidy, and then maybe have a child subsidy that doesn't depend on whether you're working, is that that could be advanced directly from employers. Right now, there used to be an advance earned income tax credit, which almost nobody used. And actually, low-income tax preparers often discouraged workers from taking it, because the problem was, if you took the advance credit and then your earning went up, you could owe the IRS a bunch of money at the end of the year. And lower income people don't have big cash reserves to pay a tax bill. But if the EITC was like a 20% tax credit on earnings up to $15,000, and you had a child tax credit, it's $1,500 a kid, which was fully refundable, that employer could advance the work credit just through the paychecks, get it, you know, knowing they would get the money back from the government as an offset of their own taxes, and there wouldn't be this risk of underpayment of tax at the end of the year. I don't know any solution other than that. I mean, you could obviously put restrictions on refund anticipation loans, but that's been difficult to do.
Hi, I'm Zach Lisko. I'm a student at Yale Law School. I had a question for David Kamin. It seems like if the question is how much we should be using the tax code to affect inequality, the question seems that it's not really, you know, the importance of the tax code for inequality versus the tax code for poverty, but rather the importance of the tax code for inequality versus the importance of education for inequality and the importance of financial regulatory reform for inequality. So is it obvious that those things are easier ways to affect inequality than through the tax code?
It's a very good question. You could say that my paper set up a false dichotomy. Like, why compare two like apples, oranges things, and why can't I have them all? Is another part of the question. So, you know, part of what I was positing is that when it comes to the tax debate, and also thinking about tax reform, that there's limited resources. And it goes to both when it comes to the question of questions of inequality and also to questions of what the tax system can affect. So, you know, if I am sitting around trying to figure out what tax reform I want, and if I'm organizing panels on it, there'll be a certain number of panels on inequality, there'll be a certain number of panels on poverty, and there's only a certain number of panels to go around. There's basically limited policymaking resources. And so I do think that there's actually a trade-off when it comes to first thinking about what the tax system can affect and the distributional effect. There's a trade-off to some degree about whether we're thinking about overall economic inequality or whether we're thinking about something else and thinking about welfare. And I think also frequently, the point that I made and that we've made that this tax system doesn't have a large effect on overall inequality is now being made increasingly by a number of books that are about inequality. And so what I wanted to say was, first, you know, if you're like thinking about taxes and you have a limited amount of resources at your disposal in terms of thinking about taxes, you may want to think about one thing more than you think about the other thing, just because I don't think that within the bounds of policymaking over the last 30 years that it's going to have that big an effect on inequality relative to overall economic trends, but I do think it'd have a much larger effect on the welfare of the people at the bottom, so you may want to think about that more. It's also, if what you care about is inequality and you have limited amount of resources to like think about and consider policies to affect inequality, you may want to lobby harder when it comes to things other than tax policy. If all you're doing is lobbying on tax policy, you're probably not putting your resources where they belong. Now, what would better affect it than taxes? I hope something exists, because if it doesn't, then it's then we're looking at a pretty dark vision of our future. So I mean, I'm not an expert in terms of what the other things will be, but I hope that things like financial regulation, things like educational policies, could be a much a bigger lever than the tax system. As I said, if it's just the tax system, then I think that it's unfortunate. I have a it's not a particularly great world.
On the earned income tax credits question, the equivalent program in Europe is delivered in littler pieces. It's little weekly and monthly checks. And if you talk to poverty experts, and there's a woman at Columbia who studies this stuff, they will say, yeah, we, you know, refund anticipation loans aside, we like smaller packages rather than the lump sum delivery specifically because it causes people to have these big spending hits and then they have no money the rest of the year. I want to look at David Kamin's slide 5 for a second, and I want to quibble about causality because when we look demographically at the 1%, and I also want to stop talking about basketball players because there's not that many of them, if we look at the 1%, it really isn't all basketball players and hedge fund managers. Some huge percentage, like 30 or 40%, and I don't have the number off the top of my head, is corporate executives. And if we look at these the way those zigzags go, we can find milestones of tax cuts in there. If you see 1981, you see that line going up, that's the Reagan tax cuts. 1986, 87, you see another line going up, that's more tax cuts. 1993, you see another line going up, that is Section 162M, which caused executive compensation to go completely crazy because it said, look, you can't pay yourself cash, but Katie barred the door on what you pay yourselves as stock. And the researchers actually at Columbia Business School have put together these tax milestones with executive compensation and basically figured out that it was the rate cuts and then 162M that caused these guys to start paying themselves all outdoors. But they do, you know, account for a bunch of the 1%, so we have an issue right there.
So it's a great question. So I think turning to, so if you don't mind, turning to slide 11. So this is the CBO's calculation of the effect of the system on inequality over that period. And you're certainly right. First, I mean, you do identify that coming out of 1981, CBO finds that the tax system was having a smaller effect in terms of reducing income inequality. And then, you know, actually, so after 1991, it actually increased. So the important to remember, 1990, 1993, we have a set of budget deals with actually progressive tax changes overall, right? That they increased taxes at the top, but and actually expanded the EITC at the same time. So, you know, even as overall economic inequality was increasing, you actually had progressive tax changes. So, you know, look, I do think that there's a question. I think what you're partly raising, and something that I don't get into, I think there is a question of whether the tax system is a signaling device. And whether the tax system, whether the marginal rates, it's not just about the traditional economic behaviors that we think of, but when you put a tax rate at high levels like they had before, whether it's 50 or 70%, and frankly, even if people were avoiding it, which I think a lot of people think that there are people who have managed to avoid those high rates, whether it actually set a signal for a society, and that people simply wouldn't take compensation at that level, or they would take a lot less of it just because there was a signaling device around it. And I think that's an important area to explore. I think in terms of at least the traditional economic effects, just, you know, the amounts people pay, I would think that what CBO captures here, so you're right, I mean, like, it did have some effect, but I think if you look at relative to the overall economic trends, that change in inequality is not massive. And in the 90s, you had a more progressive tax system, even as you had growing income inequality.
Okay. Yeah, Len, you want? I meant to pitch my book. I have a book with Joel Slemrod called Taxes in America, What Everyone Needs to Know, and apparently it has everything you need to know about taxes, and it's coming out any day now. You can order it on Amazon if you want.
And after that shameless plug, thanks to our